So hello everyone from my side, and good morning to all of you who are in the US, and good afternoon to the rest of us. So I will just quickly introduce myself. My name is Vera, and I'm originally from Ukraine, but I moved to Germany for my PhD, and today I will share with you main findings from my PhD. So I work with the 3D cortical organoids, the model of human brain development, and I'm really interested in early human brain development. And during my PhD, I was working with the healthy derived organoids as well as organoids derived from a patient with lysencephaly. What is lysencephaly? So I work with a very severe case of lysencephaly, which named Miller-Dieker syndrome. And basically, you can see now on the slide on the left-hand side, normally looking brain scan from a healthy person. On the right-hand side, you see the lysencephalic brain, and you can clearly see that there is almost complete absence of durification. So there is almost no durification happening, and ventricles are enlarged, and the surface of the brain almost completely smooth. That's why basically lysencephaly translates as a smooth brain from the Latin. And most of the study before 2014, 2013 were done mainly in mice. But there is one significant problem. Lysencephalic human brain is smooth as well as normal rodent brain is smooth. And mice doing are just fine for a million years with a smooth brain, whereas for people, for patients, it's a life-threatening disease. That's why we thought that we should find some more appropriate model for that. And since it's genetically caused disease, caused by the huge deletion along the chromosome 17, we decided that it would be a great idea to have the cells, to reprogram them, and to make organoids and see whether we can spot any kind of phenotype also in this 3D stem cell-derived model. But before I will go into more details about organoids, I just want to quickly show you. I really love this kind of cartoonish illustration of the mini brains, mini lungs, mini whatever you want to have. And when everything just started, it was just like in 2012, it was just two papers which were had title with a brain organoid in it. Whereas in 2019, there was almost 2,000 papers with the brain organoids in it. So you can see that the so-called organoid hype has started. And I think I was quite lucky one to be more or less in the beginning of that. So when I started my PhD in 2014, and I was really able to try around and to play around with the methods and protocols, which was challenging on the one hand, but was really rewarding on the other hand, because you're doing something that everything just started. So it's a really new field, and it was very exciting to work with. But of course, with the progression of the field, the protocols improved, and now the organoid protocol is quite reliable, more or less, I would say, compared to 2013 or 14. And here you see a really nice schematic representation from the Kriegstein lab, from the review, where they compare on the left-hand side, you see the human brain in its schematic cortex representation. Here is the mouse one, and here is the human organoid. And you can see that the human organoid, from a first glimpse, look quite alike to mouse one, but it contains all the human-specific type of neuronal progenitors, which is extremely important for studying some of the cortical-associated disorders. But of course, it's still way too primitive and way too small, and that's why when the journalists call it like mini brains, of course, everyone who works with that not really happy about this, because it's as far from the brain as it gets, basically. But of course, it's quite a good model. It's not perfect, but it's model. So, and if we quickly compare the organoids to like a human brain, so the organoids is up to like 4 or 5 millimeters in size and have 2 to 3 million cells, whereas human brain contains approximately 86 billion neurons. So of course, it's a huge difference. Plus, normally cortical organoids, they lack endothelial cells, microglia cells, and interneurons unless you do some manipulation to those cultures or you co-culture them together. But normally, if you focus only on cortex, you get super small amount of those, if any, of those other type of cells. So I was working with Miladika syndrome. We've got the patient cells, we've got the matching control. We develop our protocol, and basically here you can see over the time progression of this organoids. At day one, it's really round sphere, basically embryonic body spheres, everyone like to call it differently. And by day 11, you can already appreciate that they have so-called like cortical loop-like structures. So all of these small things basically will represent ventricular zone-like region of developing brain. And once you cut it through, and stain, you can see that each of this cortical loop represent ventricular zone-like region. So they are positive for progenitus marker SOX2, PAX6. I focus on the forebrain region. That's why I will also stand for something like EMX1, for example, which is the regional marker, so which proves that those neuronal progenitors within the ventricular zone-like region of our organoids are forebrain identity. Very, very few randomly distributed NKX2.1, which is interneuronal progenitor cells. And majority of the cells which are actively divided here labeled with pvmentine. On early stages, they are mainly gathered around the ventricle-like region of these cortical loops, which is also quite correspondent to and reflecting to what the normal human developing brain has in early stages. And when we compare control and patient-derived organoids, which you can directly spot, it's the size difference. So here you see the patient one, and here you see the control one. It's the same time point, 20 days. And even though we started with a double amount of cells as a starting population for patient organoids, they ended up still way smaller. And this also corresponds and goes in line with the patient data. So a lot of those patients, they have microcephaly or border-like microcephaly. And if you see here on the graph, it's basically depicted here how they progress, how fast they grow. And whereas the four control lines we had, they grow quite statically, and you can see how they grow big and big in size. Here, you see this one, that's the patient ones, and basically, yeah, they reflect quite well the end result of this. In the middle with the green, you see so-called rescued line. As I mentioned before, this is the disease which caused by the deletion along the chromosome 17. And normally, patients lose quite a lot of different genes, but two of them identified as the main one causative for those diseases. It's LIS1, lysencephaly gene 1. And genes that encodes 14-3-3 epsilon protein. And when we restore by CRISPR-Cas each of those two genes, with the size, they catch up somewhere in the middle between patient and control cells, which once again proves the point that those genes are extremely crucial for development of this disorder. So by doing this basic first characterization, we conclude that it's possible to make organoids from those iPS lines and that the patient ones are way smaller. So, okay, what does it mean way smaller? Does it mean that the cells are simply dying? So the apoptosis rate is increased. This would be a very simple reason and quite obvious, but there was no increased apoptosis in the patient-derived organoids. So there was obvious that there has to be something else. We hypothesize that if there is cells not just dying, means that something else happened to them, which one of the reasons might be that it's early neurogenesis happening there. And when we looked for so the end result would be that the progenitor pool exhausts them too fast, and they turn to neurons, and that's basically end of the story. So the amount of neurons at early time points is higher, but they do not mature longer. And this is also corresponds with some of the data which were found from the mice, but quite a lot of mice data were a little bit contradictive in this case. So we checked for the apoptosis, it was not increased, and we checked for the early signs of increased neurogenesis at early stages. And for this, we stain for TBR2 marker, which is a marker for intermediate progenitors. And at early time points, day 20, 28 of differentiation, patient-derived culture has way more amount of TBR2 positive cells, which is a sign of increased early neurogenesis. So then we wanted to know what is the reason behind that. And as I mentioned to you before, the LIS1 gene and FRIN3 epsilon, they are both missing in all of the cases of Miller-Dicker syndrome. And those proteins are extremely important for microtubule formation in the cells. So LIS1 is a direct partner of dynein, and FRIN3 epsilon is stabilizing this LIS1 dynein complex, which means that when both of them are absent, everything which involves microtubule and cytoskeleton function the cells cannot function properly. They cannot divide properly. They cannot migrate properly, and so on and so forth. So when we stain for acetylated form of the beta-3 tubulin, which is more stable form and can stain microtubuli, which were formed quite long time ago and do not disorganize during the different stages of this cell functioning. And in control, you can see that this is basically very nicely aligned, that go from the very beginning of the ventricle to the up to the surface of this ventricular zone-like region, whereas in patient one, they really, most of them go only to the middle of this ventricular zone-like region, and they are quite disorganized, and it's quite clear from this picture. And when we restore each of this gene by the CRISPR-Cas, you can see that the picture looks not control-like, but still much more like to control than the normal patient situation. We'll also look at the overall organization of so-called stem cell niche during early stages. And here you see the just normal HE staining. This is the staining for the cell cilium for erythrin B. And these two markers of two different cell-cell connection within this region. So adherent junctions labeled with enkangolin and tight junctions with ZO1. And you can clearly see that here's the patient, even just by looking how the nuclei of the cells are organized, really kind of all over the place. They are not really aligned. The orientation of the cell surface also quite disorganized compared to the control situation. And when you look at the different type of junctions, the enkangolin and ZO1, they're both present, but they way less nicely organized compared to control. So the distribution of both of them are quite different from the control situation, which made us think that there might be a problem with the entire functioning of the niche and the signaling of the niche. And in this case, enkangolin is quite tightly connected to the wind signaling. So there were reports which were studying like basic evolutionary development of the stem cell niche in early human corticogenesis, and which shows that if the cells are not really tightly packed and nicely organized during this very early stages, this will influence how the cells will divide and how fast they will exit the proliferative cycle and turn to neurons instead. So we thought that there might be something connected to enkangolin functioning, which is in turn will also connect to wnt beta-catenin axis of this signaling pathway. And we made several different experiments to see whether this could be somehow be true. We did this also in 2D with some other things. And basically what we thought to look next to really see whether this niche organization really can result in a change of how cells divide, we decided to check how they divide in general. So here's the picture of the organoid. Here's different type of pattern, how the spindle orientation can be formed. Here's the scheme of that. So if the cells divide vertically in the relation to the ventricle, then most probably it will result in asymmetric cell division. So which means that one daughter cell will stay in a close contact with this ventricle and the other daughter cell will migrate up and eventually turn to neuron. If spindle orientation is horizontal, so it's the vertical, it's symmetric, and horizontal asymmetric cell division. So symmetric or vertical will result that both daughter cells, they divide and they stay where they are in a close contact to the ventricle, and they will keep dividing, which means that they will produce more and more cells. When cells switch to asymmetric mode of cell division, means that one of the cells will migrate up and turn to neuron sooner or later. And what we found actually, that patient cells has a clear switch from symmetric to asymmetric cell division, which means that they start to exit this proliferative cycle way faster than the control cells, which means that they will produce more neurons, but unfortunately they will not provide this huge pool of progenitors, which later on will result in a smaller size of the organoids overall. And to prove whether this really the case, we again check what the cells are doing where we rescue LIS-1 of Rhenium-Sp epsilon, and we saw the almost complete restoration of this phenomenon. And what makes it especially interesting that, for example, in my studies, when they create LIS-1 knockouts or for instance Rhenium-Sp knockouts, they saw increase in oblique cell division, which somewhere in the middle between symmetric and asymmetric, and no one can be sure what kind of cells they will result in, unless you follow with the live cell imaging each of this oblique event and clearly see what's happening. So whereas in human cells, it was a clear shift from symmetric to asymmetric cell division with no significant increase in oblique cell division, which basically brought us to the realization that this switch from symmetric to asymmetric cell division, which later on will result in smaller size of the organoids and higher amount of immature neurons at the earlier time point, is coming from this disturbance of the niche organization. And to prove that it's not just can be rescued by CRISPR-Cas editing, but also pharmacologically, what we did, here is you see the normal patient-derived organoid. It's quite small, comparably small, and the ventricular zones are not that much nicely developed. And when we treat these patient cultures with the GSK3 inhibitor, which would activate the Wnt signaling and restore it to kind of a normal level, you see that the patient organoid looks quite different compared to untreated one. And to be honest, like after seeing such a huge effect, and this takes just 7 days of treatment. And when we saw such a striking effect, we couldn't really believe that this is true. But when we repeated all over and over again, and we saw that this is really keep happening with different cell lines and so on, we were really impressed and actually very happy that we did found the mechanisms that explains this. And we'll also look in the plane of cell divisions, which also were restored as good as after the rescuing the cell lines with the CRISPR-Cas editing. And when we look at the organization of the niche, it was also quite striking difference. So here you see the control once again, the patient. And this is without any gene manipulation, just with the pharmacological rescuing of this. And the same goes for organization of the cilium of the cells, for organization of the enkanterin and ZO1, which basically means the different cell connections, as well as I already mentioned, the plane of cell division. So taking this all together, we were able to show that the cortical organoids are suitable for modeling of lysencephaly, and they do reflect the key points of this disorder. We did find the cortical niche disorganization, which is also were reported in patient samples, but never really reported in mice. The same goes for the fact that we could, for the first time, show that it's wnt signaling which is involved in that, and we could rescue this by pharmacological treatment of the organoids, as well as by restoring each of the two most important genes. And basically, our general hypothesis, which turned to be out correct, that in patient cells, in patient organoids, changes in the signaling pathway within the niche cause the early neurogenesis, which is caused by the fact that the cells exit in cell cycle for proliferation too fast, and instead of having vertical symmetric cell division, they switch to horizontal asymmetric cell division, which endpoints for the early differentiation and production of too many neurons too early and exhaustion of the progenitor pool. And with this, I would like to thank you. And here, of course, all my colleagues who helped me was working on this project and funding, of course. And thank you for your attention. And I'm happy to answer any questions.